Well, good evening, everybody, and many thanks for joining us tonight for a discussion which I hope you're going to find interesting and fascinating. I'm sure it will be, because Lydia Cacho is a fascinating and superbly intelligent woman, and we will have a very good evening with her. My name is Agnès Callamard. I am the executive director of Article 19, which is a freedom of expression organization that works around the world and in particular in Mexico. And we have been working with Lydia for a number of years there. We have an office that has been working closely with Lydia because, as we probably will talk about later on in the evening, Lydia has been the target of many attacks, many threats, and indeed has been abducted and tortured several years ago. She's here this evening, having more or less fled Mexico 4 weeks ago, having received another threat to her life, a threat that many security experts took extremely seriously and indeed advised her to leave within the next 24 hours. So she has been touring, as it happened, Europe, presenting her book, but also, for the time being out of Mexico for her own safety. And maybe this is the best way to introduce Lydia. I presume that you all know a little bit about her, that you've all Googled and checked on Lydia, but I should say that she is a journalist by training and by trade. She's also a human rights activist. She's a women's rights activist. She's a strong feminist and has become very well known internationally, particularly through her work several years ago, a book that investigated a pornographic child pornography ring in Mexico, uncovering many characters in that process, including high-level politicians, businessmen, and so on. The book Los Demonios del Eden, when it was published, resulted in Lydia being abducted and tortured. The event, however, didn't stop her, didn't prevent her from continuing to speaking up and speaking out. And I think it is one of the key characteristics of Lydia, and we will be able to discover that even more fully throughout the evening. The latest threats have come about 4 weeks ago from what you were telling me, Lydia. Can you tell us what happened exactly, and how did you, what did you think, and, you know, are they linked to the book, the newest book?
Well, it's just hypothesis. We believe it's linked to this last book, but we're not really sure yet. But what happened is that during the last years after my incarceration in 2006, I have to resort to all these security strategies, and one of them is having a satellite radio with which I communicate with my lawyer in Mexico and with some of my family in case it's an emergency. So the radio was interfered, and I got this call in which someone told me that they were going to, if I wouldn't stop right now, they would send my father my body in little pieces in a bag. And this has happened to many of my colleagues in Mexico. I don't know if you're aware of this, but 72 journalists have been assassinated and abducted in Mexico in the last years during the so-called war on drugs. And the 60,000 people that have been assassinated in Mexico, many of them have been cut to pieces. So this, I took it really seriously. And I called one of the experts that helped me, and he said, get your passport and get out of there, because almost nobody can interfere such a specialized radio, satellite radio. And this must be either the military or one of the cartel leaders, and because this is very, very expensive equipment. So I did get out.
Thank you, Lydia. So you're here tonight to talk to us about your latest book, slavery ink, which is the product of your investigation over many years into the sexual trafficking business, what you refer to as the global business. It's, I presume some of you have read the book. It's a very hard book to read. It's very rich. There are many personal stories. There are many, it covers a range of countries and a range of themes. But when I was reading it, what struck me was, why did you do that? I mean, why did you pick such a topic, which is a very difficult topic to investigate to begin with, particularly difficult for a woman? And what prompted you to investigate that issue and to write that book? And what is it that you left out? Because you've investigated over many years. And is there anything that you felt you could not put in the book? And what were that?
Okay, I did it because I'm a reporter. And our reporters are stubborn, of course. We all know that. But I did it because in 2005, when I published Los Demonios del Edén, or Demons of Eden, and I uncovered this network of child pornography, of which I didn't know much about before writing that book or meeting with the victims and investigating this huge network, I started uncovering how it was child pornography was linked to sex trafficking around the world and sexual tourism, which is something we sometimes talk about, but nobody really explains how it works, right? So after I was incarcerated and everything because of that book, when I came out, I decided to talk about the issues and to keep on naming the names of the guys that were responsible for this network, criminal network. And in this presentation, a lot of people keep asking me, how the hell does it networks work, you know? And I keep looking for papers and essays and investigations of other journalists around the world to explain to me how they were interlinking. And I couldn't find an answer that was good enough for me. So I decided to do it. And I started investigating all the big mafias around the world, including, of course, the Mexican cartels, that had something to do with trafficking, not only sex trafficking, but also illegal smuggling of illegal aliens. That could be linked eventually to human trafficking in its different forms, and then to human slavery in labor and other forms of slavery. And I made this map in which I planted 141 countries that I had to visit. And I went to my editor and I said, listen, I want to do this. I want to follow this and this and these mafias. I had a list of my mafias. I know how to do it. I need the money, and it will take me like 5 years. And I want to do this. And my editor said, sure. So it wasn't, as anyone here that is a journalist knows, there's never enough money to do this thing. So I did all kinds of things to be able to travel. And it took me 5 years of traveling around the world, all over Latin America, the United States, Canada, Turkey, all Central Asia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, Japan, you name it, I was there. And then I decided I needed to develop a technique in which I would follow exactly how the mafias were doing it, how they were gathering the women and the children, and how they were able to translate, to bring these people from one country to the other, or within their own countries, how they were moving the people, and how come nobody knew about it, at least no police or immigration officers were supposed to know about it. So what I did is I started interviewing women and girls and boys that were rescued in different shelters around the world, and they told me the stories. And with that information, I investigated more and more. So I followed this girl from that was brought from Venezuela to Mexico. So I took the trail back to Venezuela, and I did the same thing with an American girl that was taken to Japan, but with a fine contract as a singer, I mean, she was not abducted or anything like really dark and ugly. It was a very fine Japanese businessman that was looking for good singers, beautiful young women in the United States. He came to her house. He signed a contract with the parents, and the parents let her go because they were a real company in Japan. They own many bars, very famous bars, and VIP clubs. And they took it there, and then they exploited her. So I went to Japan, and I followed that mafia, and I understood how the Yakuza was working and how they were laundering the money. So I did that with most of the mafias around the world to understand how they interlink and how they work. And then I also started investigating all the legal business they have in order to launder the money they make out of slavering human beings. So that's what the book is all about, basically.
And what was the most disturbing aspect of your investigation?
I guess the whole thing. I guess the most disturbing thing was, aside of course, of all the human stories and tragedies and the stories of the little girls and the boys everywhere around the world and the women, it was the fact that there are very few good policemen around the world that do understand what's going on, that really understand what's going on. And they are really frustrated because they do know there's very little they can do within the context in which they work. You have a lot of politicians that are involved in this kind of business, not necessarily directly exploiting the woman, but yes, they are involved in some kind of business that links to the money laundering, including bankers, of course. You know, have you heard about some banks that are laundering money lately? We have all around the world, and they do have to launder the money. There's a lot of restaurant businesses that are dedicated specifically to laundering the money. The taxi networks all around the world, from Thailand to Cambodia to Philippines to Mexico and Colombia and the United States. They are specialized in bringing the tourists to the special places in which the girls are or the women are to be exploited. It depends on what kind of woman or girl the client wants. They do know where to go. And so I guess the most disturbing part was to see where the discussion around the world is going. We've been discussing prostitution for, I don't know, since probably openly since the 60s. Aside of moralizing about it, like really openly, since the feminists started bringing the issue forward in a different way. And people keep discussing this thing as if it is an issue of freedom or it's not an issue of freedom. This is a criminal endeavor that is bringing millions and millions of dollars to criminals that are buying and selling human beings everywhere, and they're finding the ways through the illegal and legal markets in order to do that. They bring them by boat, they do everything. We were talking about this, Berlusconi, you know, in Italy last year. I mean, you have a president, not only that he's a cynic and he owns a lot of the media, local media, but that is a perfect example of what's going on with the trafficking of human beings and sex trafficking in particular. He is hiring this special company that brings foreign girls to politicians and rich men to have sex with. And they are teenagers. They are virgins. They come from different countries. And they are what they called in Italy, boccato di cardinale. That's what Berlusconi called the girl he was caught with. And most of our colleagues, journalists in Italy, did not cover the story as a story of the president of the country being part of a cover-up and being a client, a direct client, of sex trafficking of a teenager girl from a country in which she could have not ever have a life she was offered to have in Italy. And they were surprised when I was discussing this with them. They were like, no, she was a prostitute. I'm like, no, she was a human being. She was a teenager. She was brought by this company in an illegal way. And she was exploited sexually, and she was brought to these guys that are really powerful. And they want really young women because they need them to be silenced. They need them not to speak the local language, not to understand they are with this or that politician. And they need them to be grateful to the guy who wants to have sex with them for money, because in their own country they wouldn't even have food. Hmm. So that's most frustrating, as you can tell. I'm frustrated about it.
So what you're also talking about is what we were discussing earlier on when we've met, the ideological framework which allows the sex trafficking to persist and to grow, which is not just an ideological framework based on violence, but is a fairly more sophisticated one. Of course, it includes sexism and patriarchy, and you talk a lot about it, but also money making is a big, you know, there is a fantastic quote at some point of the businessman who says, it's a business, it's a business, it's the business. Stop screwing us. Yeah. And I thought that was, I mean, you know, the idea that this is just a money-making enterprise came very strongly in your book, coupled with, maybe more recently, all this discussion around the free will and the freedom of women to engage into this activity. So the ideological framework for sex trafficking is actually far more complex than what we could have expected originally. At least that's what I thought your book conveyed. And is it something that you've also discovered in the process of investigation?
Yes, of course. Then it takes me back to the question at the beginning that said, what did I left out? When I finished the book, it was 800 pages long. And my editor said, are you crazy? Nobody's going to read this. I mean, so I had to leave a lot of stuff out. And some of this stuff were really interesting interviews with experts around the world, especially economists and people that really understood what free trade means nowadays in the world. And another thing that I'm not so sure it's quite clear in the book, and I wish it was, because I think it's really important, is that most of the people, I mean, of course, you have this guy. Okay, I'm going to stop here and go back a little. But you have this guy in the sex trade. There's a sex fair in Las Vegas, a very, very famous international sex fair that is, like, you can watch it on HBO every year. And so you can go in there and interview everyone, because everyone is selling everything, human beings, pornography, sex toys, and the fun of sex. And I wanted to interview the chief of them all. It's like the biggest producer of pornography in the US, but he's also one of these guys that is training young men and young women to make the pornography that really sells nowadays, you know, to make it more modern. And when I went to him and I started asking questions and I said, how do you feel about this? And of course, with a fake card, I never said, I'm a feminist, you know, so he wouldn't give me the interview. So, and then he said, don't make a mistake. No, he just looked at me like, oh, poor woman, you know. He said, this is business. You know, we're selling things. That's it. It's business, business, and business. When he said we're selling things, then I did understand everything they meant. I mean, they truly believe that human beings can become objects. And once you objectify someone, you take away the free will, of course, because you convince them they are a thing. And that's what they do with teenage girls. And that's why pornography around the world is becoming, if you see it, it's younger and younger women and men, because they're training them in order to feel and believe that it's all right to become an object, and this is, you know, this is just a business.
That links up probably to the other important, what I felt was the important theme in your book. You know, we often hear with in movies, Hollywood has sometimes tried to portray the breaking of the woman for the purpose of sex trafficking. Yeah. And almost all of these representations are using extreme form of violence. And in fact, the media tend to report on breaking of the woman through extreme form of violence. But what your book is demonstrating is actually the breaking of the woman for sex trafficking purposes is a far more sophisticated and subtle and therefore much more deeper form of torture. And it involves high level of cruelty in some cases, but there is a lot of soft violence, quotation mark, of course, the use of pornography in the house where the woman lives, like to make it part of a normal way of being, the drugs, the reward system, and the psychological destructions. And most importantly, I think what you're also showing is that that breaking of the woman is made more easy in many ways, because many of these women come from either a family or community or a culture that has glorified violence against women, and that many of them have escaped violence against women. Yeah. Am I making too much of that?
No, I think you're absolutely right. One thing that was really interesting to me when I was traveling around the world was I found it incredible how similar the culture in Vietnam is to the culture in Mexico, Guatemala, Nicaragua, and El Salvador. I never thought of it until you understand how poverty works, how families that are living on extreme poverty start using their own children to survive. Not only to, I mean, it's not that they decide to exploit their children because they're mean and awful parents. It's that they come from generations of people that have never had a real chance at life. They never had a break for anything. They never got education or health or anything. So they are there in extreme poverty, and all of a sudden they have all these children, and somebody from the town comes to them, somebody usually that they know, and tells them, oh, you know, you have two little girls, and I can bring them to this big city, and they can become housemaids, and they will make money, and they will go to school, they will make a better life than this, in this dump, and then we will send you a little money. So, who, you know, which parent wouldn't allow that to happen? Of course you do want that to happen. So they did accept the girls or the boys to be sent to a different place, and then all of a sudden they would lose contact to them, and they are citizens that are not taken into account by the government because they are poor. They do not exist. There's millions and millions of poor people. I'm only talking about poor people, then we'll go back to the people who is not poor, but it's also in this industry. And then you have these girls in Vietnam or in Cambodia and Thailand that every day go from their little house walking to a certain place in which the guy with a big car is picking them up to take them to the brothel. And then at night they bring them back. And people cannot understand how that can happen. And they keep saying, no, but it's not like in the movies, you know, they don't have them on the chains and suffering and torturing them. No, it's psychological torture. They're training them to become sexual objects for others. And when they train them to do so, they also convince them that this is the only chance society is giving them. So they better take it, because the welfare of their own family, it's in their hands. So some of these 12 or 13-year-old girls in Guatemala or Vietnam or Cambodia believe they are doing a great thing for their family. They're bringing food back home, you know, even if it's $5 a week for being with 50 or 60 clients a week. So they don't know better. And they have never, ever had sexual education. Forget anything about appropriation of their body or eroticism. Forget about that. Of course not. So they have no idea about that. And these are the girls that all of a sudden, when they turn 25, somebody tells them, one of the pimps tells them, okay, now you're too old. Now you will become a madam. You will train the little girls, you know? And she'll say yes. because she was educated in this industry. And this is what women are for. So this is not like a mean, crazy madam from the movies. This is a woman that after 5 hours of interview will keep on telling me, what, is there a different world? Is it different in Mexico? Haven't you done that in Mexico in order to become a journalist or something? Of course. So it's understanding the other, the position in which the other is put, and understanding how their own personal histories and the local history and the political situation and the policies on gender issues that make you understand where this is going. And I think the discussion on sexual trafficking right now around the world must really, really focus also on the fact that not only there's gender inequality, but also people are becoming commodities. And it seems to me that a lot of liberals think that that is very cool, you know? It's all right. It's this prostitute in Spain said to me, my body is my enterprise, and I am the boss of my enterprise. And then after 2 hours of interview, she ended up telling me how her father raped her when she was a little girl. But she thinks that that happens to almost every girl, so, you know, she got over it. So when you remember, if you remember that back in the 70s, you know this, Agnès, mm-hmm. because you're also feminist, but back in the 70s, when we started talking about domestic violence, a lot of people kept saying women chose to be in a violent relationship, didn't they? A lot of people did. Politicians, policemen, women, men, everyone. And then most of the police around the world back then, even though we had laws against the domestic violence, they said if a woman is not beaten off enough, you know, if the face is not all red, if she doesn't have broken bones, then there's no violence. Because we thought back then that physical violence, it was the real form of domestic violence. Right now, around the world, all experts, the real experts from Turkey to Mexico, understand that the syndrome of the battered woman has a lot to do with psychological violence, which is probably the worst form of violence. And that's why torturers use psychological violence more than they use physical violence, because that's something that you cannot trace back. You cannot go back to that. And I know that when I was tortured for 20 hours by the police in Mexico, I kept thinking at the beginning they were going to do some more physical harm to me. But then all of a sudden I started understanding what they were doing. It was psychological, because they kept making me believe that I was going to be alive, and 5 minutes later they kept telling me how I was going to die and putting a gun in my mouth. And after 20 hours of that, you just tell them you're going to do whatever they tell you to do. And it was only 20 hours. And I'm here and I'm alive and I'm all right, after a lot of therapy, of course. But then if you live under this situation all your life, you're trained to obey anything they tell you. And if you're a woman or a girl in this case, you're trained to obey the pimps or the madams and to understand that sexual violence is all right.
Lydia, we haven't talked yet about, I guess, what is a key dimension of that global business and the demands. The clients, the men. Not that I want to objectify them either. I mean, at some point you do try to talk about the clients and the men, and you make some reference to the fact that in fact it's, you know, basically every man. You know, it's the men who are in their house with their wives and watching television and, you know, going and seeing a young woman on the side. I was wondering as I was reading the book, because you didn't really elaborate that much on the clients, at least not in the 300 pages, maybe in the 800.
In the rest.
Did you did you feel that there were major differences between the men as clients and the men as traffickers?
Well, then, yes, maybe there are some different basic differences. First of all, I have to say, for the ones who haven't read the book, and I hope you read, of course, that in order to understand what was going on, I really needed to interview the clients. And the only way to do it was to dress up as a prostitute. I remember calling some of my friends, colleagues from different newspapers around the world and asking them how they did it when they went to Thailand or Cambodia. And all of a sudden I noticed I was calling only male journalists that did this. And they said, well, I just went into a club, you know, and talked to the girls. And I was like, yeah, sure, but I can't. If I go in there, I have to go as a prostitute, right? So I did that. I had to dress up as a prostitute, and that was a whole process. You know, I kept reading Gunther Wallraff. I don't know if you're familiar with his work, a German, very famous, controversial journalist. And then I met with him, and he has this theory of saying that sometimes, as a journalist, you have to have very clear what you're doing, but sometimes you have to dress up as a different character in order to infiltrate that area or that business in order to document what's going on. So I did follow his trainings, and I did dress up as a nun in one situation in order to go in to document the sex trafficking of little girls in Mexico and other countries, and as a prostitute in many, many countries. I did that. I did the pole dancing and the whole thing. So I interview clients all over. And one of the things that was really caught my attention was that everything that I've seen in the movies or even read in some newspapers, that I tend to believe that it's probably fake reporting, is these guys that I interview in Dominican Republic, in Cuba, in Colombia, in Argentina, in Mexico, in the U.S., everywhere, they're not these nasty, ugly guys. They're just these doctors and journalists and writers and engineers, you know, nice guys, nice-looking guys in general, that had some money, you know. Well, most of them were married, and they were there on business, for example, on a business trip. And all of a sudden, their friend said, oh, okay, let's go to a nice bar where they have girls, and they went there. And all of a sudden, they were not women or girls. They were prostitutes, right? And I understood by listening to them that when they say this is a prostitute, they take the humanity out of the woman. So it doesn't matter if she's 16, as most of them are, 17, or if she's 21. I was far too old for them. So they were talking to me as if I was a madam, like, oh, well, you know, she's old, she's all right. No, not dangerous at all. And then the traffickers are fairly different, because traffickers, clients in general, except, well, if you want, we can go back to the pedophilia thing and everything, but clients in general, the clients that look for teenage girls and for young women around the world, tend to believe that they are not guilty of anything. Because these women and these girls have no chains. This German guy told me outside of a brothel in Nepal, he said, they have no chains. I don't see any chains, do you? So I didn't say anything to him. The clients are not aware of the crime they are committing, but they're also not aware of how huge their participation is in this terrible crime. And some of them in Dominican Republic, in Costa Rica, are paying $3,000 to be with one of these women or girls. And one of the girls or the woman gets between $10 and $5. For each client. So you can understand who's making money here. And then the traffickers, the traffickers are like this, most of them, I mean, all the ones I met, men and women, traffickers, they are so convinced it is so okay to sell human beings. You know, it's like, okay, she's poor, she's needy, or he's poor, he's needy, I will feed him. He owes me. you know, there's a whole chapter about this. The traffickers, there's little towns everywhere around the world in which a lot of men and some women, but mainly men, are becoming professional traffickers, sex traffickers. They are getting girls to fall in love with them and moving them from Mexico to the U.S. to be exploited in brothels in New York, for example, like the Carreto family, who was recently sentenced in New York for the guys were marrying girls in Puebla, in the city of Puebla and Tlaxcala, and bringing them, and they ended up bringing almost 500 young women that they marry, fakely marry in Mexico and brought to the U.S. to be exploited in a brothel. And then what I did was I followed the tracks that these guys did, because I wanted to understand if for a guy to cross the border, the American border, with papers, with a minor saying that it's her wife, he needs an American immigration officer that is corrupted and knows what's going on. He also needs a Mexican immigration officer that is corrupted. So I followed the tracks of everyone that was involved to understand exactly how the networks work. And that's what I did around the world. And most traffickers are really proud of what they're doing. And no wonder why they're proud, because there's around the world this cultural thing that is coming back really strongly, in which prostitution and pornography are like, you know, the good thing, the you know, a thing to do. It's all right. It's supposed to be freedom, right? And in any case, you challenge that discourse of freedom, and sexual freedom, prostitution and pornography and sexual exploitation as a form of free trade and sexual freedom, then they tell you you're moralizing. And then when you go back and say, listen, I want a free sex life for everyone, I think everybody should be, you know, having a lot of sex and enjoying it a lot with anyone they want, but consensual sex without exploiting anyone and without depending on the hunger of the people or the poverty of the people or the necessity of the person from one country that is in war to go to another country that is not in war, then we'll talk. Because that's one of the discussions we had to have.
Well, why don't we have it then? as you know, it has been a big debate that has created much tensions within the feminist communities. I mean, there are a few, and that's one of them. The debates around prostitution versus sex work, around legalizations and regulations versus getting rid of it altogether. And you're taking a very strong stand in your book, arguing that the discourse on sex working and on the legitimation of prostitution as a valid form of occupation is actually feeding into the sex trafficking and is justifying the exploitation of children and women around the world. How has this position been received? I mean, because I'm sure, I don't know, maybe some people here may disagree with that position, but have you had debates? And
I have to say something. When I started the investigation, I kept thinking, you know, I wasn't very sure. I had a lot of questions in my mind still. You know, I had talked a lot with women that, not only in Mexico, in other countries in Latin America and Spain, that were creating these groups of the rights of the sexual workers and all that. So I was very respectful for that, of those women and what they were saying. I listened to them, of course. So when I started my book, I had all these questions. And I talk about this in the book. And then after 5 years of interviewing these women and young women around the world, I took a position. I needed to. I just understood things. It's probably 0.1% of the women who are truly free in a certain position, and most of them are exploiting other women. Most of them end up exploiting other women. The rest of them get into the sex trade for many, many reasons. One of them is the gender violence in general, but the normalization of objectification of women and the lack of choices. And I will give you try to be quick, but this is an example that is really interesting. I studied three countries, two that legalized prostitution. One of them is Germany, as you know, the other one, the Netherlands, and then the other one is Turkey. Very few people knows that Turkey, a lot of people will think it's progressive in certain things, but it's very conservative in others. In Turkey, prostitution is legal. And the owner of all the brothels in Turkey is the government. The government is the big pimp, you know? It is, absolutely. And they run these brothels, and they allow me to go into the brothels. I understand how safe these women are. They have a doctor that is checking them not to be sick and not to, you know, this health control of prostitutes in order to protect the clients, of course, not to protect them. And then I saw this, and this, like, women in their 40s, 40-something, not very happy, not very good-looking. And I'm like, are you sure these are the brothels or the clients are coming from? I mean, like, all the rage that is in internet for the hot Turkish prostitutes. Are you sure this is? Yes, this is it. So then I went on and investigate the real prostitution in Turkey. And then you have all these high, very, very nice nightclubs that are basically run by the Turkish mafia with the Russian mafias. And they have really young women from Eastern Europe and from Cambodia, from Colombia, from you name it. But they have the divided in certain areas because it depends on what the clients want. And right now, Turkey has a huge tourism enterprise with gay tourism. They are very, very big in gay tourism. People love Turkey to go there. So now they are creating brothels of young men for the gay tourists. So this is the gay tourists that are creating a new market. They look for it on internet. They hire them in internet. It's a very fancy thing. They bring the guy to the hotel in a very nice hotel. There's nothing ugly or dark about it, you know. And this young man comes to the hotel. The client, you know, has sex with the young man. The client pays to the special agency, tourist agent, and then that's it. He goes back home. And then the young man that gets nothing for it, it's been exploited. And also he's in an illegal market in Turkey because it's illegal to be a male prostitute. So then you have all these gay guys that are illegal themselves. They are doing something that could end up, they could end up in jail forever for doing such a crime as having sex with another man, and then for being a prostitute. So they are, of course, you see no physical change in these guys, but you certainly know that they are slaved by this company. But tourism is increasing there. So you have to link all these businesses with one another, you know, and that's what I try to do.
I will open up the discussion in a minute to the audience, so please prepare your question. But I just had one or two more points. One point that I thought was very difficult in the book in many ways, and that surprised me, the fact that you didn't make a lot of distinction between sexual exploitation of children and sexual exploitation of women, taking 18 years old or even 16 as, you know, that legal boundary or even cultural boundary that we have created in the West. And it felt as if you were basically arguing in your book that distinction is not very helpful, and that in many ways we need to rethink how we think about sexual slavery and the distinction we may make between sexual slavery of children versus sexual slavery of women. Is that something that you experienced when you were investigating it, that this distinction was very difficult to carry forward?
This is quite complex, but really important, I believe. I mean, specialists have to write a lot of books about it. I'm not a specialist, but I think that a lot of people has to go into that as a social phenomena. But if any of you in this room have surfed the internet for pornography, you know by now how much teenage pornography there is in the internet. And if you don't, just try it. Just write down teen sex, and then you'll be surprised at what you'll see. It is free, supposedly, apparently. It's real sex between teenagers and adults and teenagers. And then all of a sudden, you see these sites of Hustler and all these magazines that used to sell in the streets that now have sites, internet sites, that are handled by the Russian mafia. There's a movie. The movie is really bad, but the movie is based on reality, how the Russian mafia discovered, like, almost 10 years ago, that the real business of pornography, of regular pornography, was going down, you know, economically. And they knew that pornography, the real, the good pornography was on the internet. And it was getting, the clients were demanding younger and younger people, and they were demanding different things. And by different, I mean more violent and rape or rape-like pornography. So at one time, you can find more than 50 million pages of pornography on the internet that are open to anyone. And then, so these Russian guys saw that there was a business, and they started it in Las Vegas. Of course, Las Vegas, it's a paradise for all, it all. But now they are working all over the world, including Playa del Carmen, Mexico. There's a small group of Russian mafia that is really strong there. What they did was they found the legal loop to get people to buy child or teen pornography, which is illegal in most countries in the world, through companies that have nothing to do with pornography. So you put your credit card and you buy pornography of, let's say, I don't know, girl on girl, 15-year-olds, or group rape of young boys. By young boys, and then you put your credit card, and your credit card comes, your bill comes out as if you went to a doctor visit, to an optometrist. And I did this. I have all I'm talking about. I have evidence, because we did all these things. So there's someone here that knows about this. And I interview all these special agents around the world. The UK has a great group of specialized police in child pornography, and they know about all this, and they're trying to tackle it. And it's awful, because the mafias are so fast and so powerful into it that they are really not enough men and women to do the job, but they are trying to tackle it anyway. So when you start understanding this and investigate this for 5 years, you understand this. There are many reasons why the clients around the world are looking for younger and younger women and men, or boys in this case. And the reason is very simple. Sex is out there in the open. It's not the same thing as it was 40 years ago. There's very little less taboo about sexuality or teen sexuality and all. The media has been a part of it. So we talk about freedom of expression, of sexuality, for example, and I think, yes, let's do that. Let's talk about sexuality with the kids, to the kids. But then some people do it the right way, and I'm not moralizing, and some people do it to get them to do things they don't really understand. And there's the trick, that we are not understanding how fast the mafias are moving, because they are creating cultural trends. The mafias of sex exploitation around the world are creating cultural trends that in 15 or 20 years we will regret we didn't really pinpoint them and said this is something that is happening in our countries and in every country, because the internet opened up the doors. It doesn't matter if the girl or the boy speaks the language or not. She can be raping one country and the videotape can be sold in another. So when I investigated the cases of child pornography in Cancun, of the 200 kids that were abused and raped and taped, some of these videotapes ended up in countries like Germany and France and the United States and Canada. And the clients that were watching these tapes didn't care where the girls or the boys came from. They were just enjoying that. And nobody's really looking for these children or these young women. And then on the other hand, the guys that are really producing this pornography or exploiting these young men and women know one thing. Clients are asking, and I will go back to the ex-president of Italy. I really like that guy because he's such a good example for this. These guys are looking for young men or young women that do not really understand how to defend their rights. See, you now have all these syndicates of groups of women and men or transgender that are doing this and saying, we are sex workers and we want our rights, you know, so I won't be raped. You will have to use a condom. You won't do this to me. I won't kiss you. But all of a sudden, if you are president of country and you order a 15-year-old girl, then she won't say anything about her rights. She doesn't even know she has a right. Because in every country in the world, if you're not 18 or more, you're not even a citizen, are you? So this is all what this is all about. This is the tendency is to look for younger and younger because they do not know their rights, because they do not know how to defend themselves. But then on the other hand, they are exploring. So they are great for the market. Right? We were 15, 16. You know, somebody licks your ear and you go like, oh my God. So they know that and they are using that against the rights and the lives and the integrity of young men and women.
All right. Well, I have many more questions, but I'm sure so do you. So, let's start. I think you hey. Yeah.
Hi, Lydia.
Maybe introduce yourself quickly.
I'm Stana Buchowska. I'm a co-founder of La Strada, a Central and Eastern European network against trafficking in persons, 70 years ago. And I just would like to follow up on your thoughts on different legal provisions on prostitution. So I did the comparative studies on Dutch and German model of legalization of prostitution. And on the other hand, I took the Swedish model where there is a criminalization of prostitution.
Of the client. The Swedish model, they criminalize the client,
buying,
not the prostitution.
Of buying sex. Okay, so criminalization of clients. Sorry. Yes, of course. No, okay. And I came into the conclusion that neither Dutch and German model nor Swedish model will help to fight trafficking, because what happened to the Netherlands and to Germany is that, okay, if you are EU citizen, you can run your own enterprise abroad. But what you need to be illegal, you need to have a legal permit to work, you need to have a legal permit to stay. And who is in all clubs in the Netherlands or in Germany are women from other countries than EU countries. So they are illegal. And what happened to them? They are even more illegal after this law was introduced back in 2002. So they went underground.
Absolutely.
Only clients know and know how to have access to them. But neither police nor social services have access to them.
Absolutely,
what's happened in Sweden, and it is also very, in my opinion, it is very strange provision to make selling sex legal, but to make buying sex illegal. It's like if you set up your...
Well, I have to say something, because I talk about that in my book. I have to say something. We're quite... obsessed with the timing. We want everything to come out like really fast. I have to say that the Swedish law has been there for a very, very short time. And I've been going to Stockholm in particular to follow six cases. And in these six cases of the woman, basically all of them were from Africa. They were illegally brought there, exploited, and blah, blah, blah. And what happened was, the government applied the new law and they gave them choices, real choices. All of them are studying. I kept interviewing them. They are all studying. They're changing their life. They were allowed to bring their children that were captured by the trafficker back in Africa. They have real visas and they have a chance to work. they are so happy. They're really happy. I mean, I'm not saying that all cases will be like that. I interview one other woman that said, I want to be a prostitute. I hate the government. But what they are doing is, I think they are on the right track. I don't know what will happen. We have to wait until we document enough cases. But what happened in Germany and the Dutch model is, yes, most of the, in a country like the Netherlands or Germany, which gender equality is basically very good, has a very high level compared to other countries like mine, for example. What you have is, if you ask your, you know, any woman in general in the street, hey, are you German? Yeah. Would you like to be a prostitute or a journalist or a banker? You know, just think about it. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you go to the brothels and to the windows, and all the women are from Eastern Europe, from Africa, from Latin America. Why? Because this market is still going like that. When you have gender equality, the women don't want to go into that thing, you know, except if they are really poor or they have no real choices. So we have to start discussing which countries have real choices and what's going on with the women there. Are they making the choice, informed choice of becoming prostitutes or not? Mm-hmm. I think we have to start discussing it from there, you know?
I just would like to finish with the Swedish model, which, I mean, and we in Central and Eastern Europe experienced this, one of the negative side effects, unfortunately, of the Swedish model, which is the sex tourism from the Swedish clients who are going abroad to have the sex services because it is punished in their countries. So it is a factor conducive to trafficking in the neighborhood countries, but also in Thailand. And I'm just finishing. And it happened that there are underground brothels out of the cities where police is not,
I will disagree. I want to disagree with you. I have to say this. If you say that the fact that the Swedish law is implemented in Sweden, it's creating a negative effect in other countries in Eastern Europe. I don't think that's the right approach from my perspective. My perspective is the Swedish law is one effort to really get gender equality and to get rid of trafficking. And then what would happen, what would need to be happening right now is what Agnès asked a while ago, is to understand this is a global thing. So if you don't go to the UN and talk to every freaking country in the world and say, okay, if you start going with your anti-trafficking laws, we have to agree in one. And this anti-trafficking law has to do with why clients want to go to the countries in which they can do things they cannot do in their own country. It's like why Mexico is becoming the Latin American Thailand. Well, because the Americans and Canadians cannot go any longer to Canada, to Cambodia and Thailand. They're coming to Mexico. So in Mexico, we're creating laws against
child sexual tourism. I was not talking about the follow-up and strategies, but just compare the 10 years, because coincidentally, the German, Dutch, and Swedish law were established at the same year, 2002. So 10 years of this. What I would like to just say that there is a lot of underground, you know, in Sweden, where the women from Russia and other Soviet Union countries are in the mobile houses somewhere in the middle of the forest, and nobody has access to them beside of the clients who are, well informed.
But the Swedish government is talking about that openly. Two months ago,
of course, I doesn't say that it's you know, I didn't say that the Swedish law is bad. I just would like to conclude now that neither the Dutch and German model nor Swedish model solve the problem of trafficking. And I agree with you that we need to see it as a problem of the violation of human rights, strictly connected with the problem of migration, legal problem of the poverty, problem of the international organized crime, problem of the domestic against women, and so on and so on. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe the man in the back, and then we come back to the front.
Thank you very, very much indeed. I'll certainly be buying, and I'm a former British customs officer, and I will be alerting colleagues who now work in the border agency and work closely with CEOP, which I think was the organization you're referring to. I've also seen, while working abroad in the ex-Soviet countries and the ex-Yugoslav countries, the impact of the Turkish-Russian mafia on human trafficking and indeed on the corruption of the law enforcement agencies there with literally fatal consequences. And I've seen Berlusconism in Dubrovnik in a really quite blatant and dramatic way. In a restaurant, not a nightclub, in a restaurant.
Yes.
Pure Berlusconism linked to the fancy yachts out on the coast. My question is, you've used the word link this and link that, which really has to be shouted from the rooftops because too many people don't link it. Do you find the situation between of work by law enforcement agencies with NGOs, is it getting better?
Absolutely.
And if so, how and how fast?
Absolutely. Actually, there's a huge campaign right now against Facebook. I don't have Facebook. Facebook don't like me. I pick a huge battle with Facebook because they have thousands of pages of child pornography in Facebook, and they won't close them down because it's not good business for them. But what this huge group around the world has done, which is amazing, is men and women around the world, that some of them are hackers, some of them are just whatever, doctors or students, whatever, that find child pornography in their own country. What they do is they tell the local police, and local police is, what they are doing is they are demanding Facebook to not to close immediately the profiles in Facebook, because when if you see a page of child pornography in Facebook of guys that are sending messages where to find the girls and the boys and blah blah blah, if you tell Facebook there's child pornography here, and these guys are saying they're going from the UK to Mexico to Playa del Carmen to do it, and this way and that way, and these are all the guys that are doing, and this is the pictures of the little girls and boys that are being abused in Mexico by UK citizens, then if you tell that to Facebook, Facebook will immediately erase the profile. Taking away the power of the UK police to get together with the specialized police in Mexico to get these guys and to rescue the kids. So there's a huge effort that is going on around the world with these agencies. And in some cases, I've seen rescues, which are just really wonderful, hopeful for a lot of people, even of the victims, which just happened recently this year. I think this is the first year in which the world has seen the rescue of little girls and boys that were sexually exploited, and they were found through pages of child pornography through Facebook. So yes, I do. I've seen a lot of. I tried to document some of them, and of course, I can't document everything. But I tried. Mm. There's all these people around the world that are doing incredible good efforts. So yes, if you find a page like that, you let the Scotland Yard police know, because there's actually a web page in which you can let them know, and they'll follow through. Good news.
Hi, my name's Alex Duffy. It's a brief question. Underpinning all the complexity of this discussion seems to be the issue of worldwide organised crime groups, the mafias. Yeah. And you've clearly had a lot of experience coming up against them over the 5 years. Did you find that there is any real political will to tackle organised crime? And do you think it's even possible to tackle organised crime?
Okay, now you're depressing me. No, well, I cannot speak about politicians in general. I found politicians in many, many countries. I can tell you, in Kyrgyzstan, I found this guy that used to work for the KGB in office, and he was the chief of immigration office in Kyrgyzstan. And he was really, really rescuing, doing incredible rescues of girls and boys. One of these examples I write in the book. And this guy came from the KGB, from the ugly side of it. And all of a sudden, he's rescuing the girls from his own country, Uzbekistan, not to be brought to the Arab Emirates to be exploited as domestic servants. So he he's working with some of the politicians in their own country that are rescuing the notion that citizens in their own country have a nation and have a country, and they can't be safe and they should be saved. So I found efforts like this in Afghanistan, for example, of people that keep saying that what war did to that country, you know, how they destroyed the NGOs, and they debilitated all the work that was being done to protect the girls in Afghanistan, and now they're trying to take that back. And these soldiers that were talking to me in the border of Afghanistan, they know some politicians that are willing to change things. So I think it comes down to a room like this, you know, it's just human beings. One by one, it's networking around the world, and then all of a sudden we'll have more people willing to change things than people not willing to.
But Lydia, if I may continue, I mean, in the book, what you do uncover a lot is corruption at the highest level, because most of these organized crimes, particularly around sex trafficking, does need some kind of political allies, and of course allies within the police and the army, but isn't it, you know, in spite of all the nice stories you're pointing out, at least the trend that emerges remains one of corruption, no?
Yes, but I think we have to start, I mean, I don't think this will change, at least in my lifetime, but I think it will eventually change, you know? So if we learn how to use examples like the Berlusconi case of these high-profile examples in the United States with the mayor of New York and stuff like that. Then we teach people. We help a society understand. That is one of the roles of journalists, at least talking as a journalist, is to help people understand that the debate can move from here, where it's not doing anything good for anyone, to here, in which you are just shedding light into the different issues and making it a human debate, not a political debate only. So, yes, I think that once we start shaming these politicians, some of them will eventually either stop or at least try to change things because it's convenient to them. When I will just give you a very quick example, but you know this, and yes, when I was arrested, well, illegally arrested and incarcerated because of the other book in 2005, a lot of people said, oh, you're a heroine and blah, blah, but things will never change. They said, these politicians are so powerful, they have the control of everything, including the judicial system, there's no rule of law in Mexico, you know, they're going to kill you for nothing. So then, at the end of last year, I got this call from a judge, from a federal judge, and I went to his office. I thought, wow, another lawsuit. I was ready to call Article 19 immediately. And all of a sudden, I got into his office, and this guy, there's this judge, and he said, listen, I want to talk to you because we just informed Jan Sukarkuri, the main character in that book, in Demons of Eden, that he has been sentenced to 112 years. For child pornography and sex trafficking of children and women. And this is the first sentence ever in Latin America. And this happened not only because of my book, obviously because of the brave girls and boys that told on these guys. But then this judge was able to do this because he read the book, he saw the reaction of the public, and he said, I'm not willing to be scared. And he told me that he was threatened many, many times when these mobsters knew that he was in charge of the case. He told me all this story. I mean, he went into it and he said they wanted to kill me, they called me, they offered me money and blah, blah, blah. And I kept thinking, if this woman that wrote the book is not even their children, did not give up, I won't give up. So it comes to that, it comes up to that. I know it sounds corny to some people, but it's not. Mm-hmm. You know, you network. If criminals network so easily, why couldn't we? I think we should. I don't know.
All right. I'll come back to you. Just one more in the back. Yeah.
My name's Jennifer. I actually have a couple questions. One was, you touched on it, but then you didn't go back to it. You talked a lot about the linking and how children and women from poverty end up exploited, but mm-hmm. and then you touched on women who don't come from poverty. Mm-hmm. If you could revisit that, because you didn't really kind of elaborate on that piece of it. And then the second point is it kind of goes back to the social change that you're referring to, and what I find is quite probably over the last 5 years, you see this glamorization of prostitution, whether it's Diaries of a Call Girl, the book, the follow-up book, the television series, dating sites. Mm-hmm. And could you comment on that as well? Because I've really noticed it over the last 5 years, and I'm not quite sure what the driver is in this glamorization.
Absolutely. You have a great author here in the UK that wrote a book about that. Yes, glamorization of prostitution and of pornography, it's terrible everywhere, but it's hitting on teenage girls especially, you know. Some people do it, like some singers do it. They have to, I don't know if you remember this, but I think it's a very good example because we use it back in Mexico in our campaigns in schools with teenagers, and it's really good. We show this video in which you see a very famous American singer that used to be a Disney singer, you know. And all of a sudden, she's very famous. She's singing there. And all of a sudden, when she tried to demonstrate she's a woman, the first concert she goes to, she dresses up as a prostitute, you know, the whole thing. The whole enchilada goes like that. And she thought that the only way to demonstrate that she was, like, now a mature singer of 19, right? Then it was dressing up like that. So there's this message everywhere, and they're being bombarded by that. And I guess that in many, many countries, parents do not know, they don't have the tools or the information to talk to them without going like, oh, no, that's really bad, you know, Virgin Mary is going to punish you for that. So, or moralizing or saying this is bad, but not being able to debate with their kids about it. And I think sexual education has to come to another level and have a gender perspective, absolutely. Because you see, if any of you have the chance, you have to read this book, Sin Tetas No Hay Paraíso. It's a Colombian book. And then they had the series. The series I don't like, but the book is good. And it's all about this. You know, I met hundreds of young girls in Colombia that dream of the day they turn 15, because in their sweet 15th birthday, the gift is prosthetic breasts, you know. And some of the parents are like saying, you know, I don't know what to do because it's what they want. And you go like, well, you tell them that their breasts are all right. They're very nice, you know. So when there's nothing wrong with them, I teach them to give the money to give a prosthetic leg to someone that really needs something artificial in their body. So it's just like this, teaching people, also parents, to have, you know, the possibility to learn how to tackle this awful culture of and I try to explain it in the book, but it is the sex industry who's doing this. I mean, they're really paying a lot of money, a lot of time in public, in television around the world to show this. They are making movies and teaching girls to feel that this is all right, and also teaching boys, of course, that girls that look like, I don't know, things, and prostitutes are the it thing, you know, the hot thing.
You're absolutely right. I work in the field of domestic violence, and right now we're seeing domestic abuse in teen relationships. I don't really need that. Is absolutely skyrocketing, and it's intimately linked to the consumption of pornography. The boys expect the girls, so they watch this pornography from when they're really young. So when they have their first sexual experience, the girl is like a prop. And the girls buy into this, and this is why we have all this kind of sexting business going on. Boys asking girls to send, you know, pictures of their bits, and of course the girls do, and then they get cold slags. And so it starts, you know, and it's this desensitization of taking the emotion out of it, and that's the problem we're finding. And then, of course, the violence kicks in as well. You get situations where girls are sort of inducted into gangs because they're, say, like, desperate to belong to something.
And there you see the pornography and the violence coming together, younger and younger ages. And the law here, you can't really be considered as a sort of domestic violence case unless you're 18. And yes, a lot of it's happening 16, 18, and even younger. So that's something that our legal system has to recognize.
Yeah, exactly.
I think we had a question here.
Just a remark. You mentioned those 500 pages you unfortunately couldn't publish. Norbert, Better World Links. Why not put them on the internet? I would think that's a jolly good idea.
Yeah,
like they do with the films. They have an extra CD-ROM.
Uncut.
With the
yes, uncut films. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. I have your card, by the way.
Yes.
Thank you. My name is Helena. I'm a Portuguese journalist. I was just wondering, in terms of awareness campaigns, how much do you think it can actually be done? Because you mentioned the equation between poverty and exploitation, and that seems like a really hard one to tackle. I was just remembering this story of this boy somewhere in Asia that still remembered the pamphlet he read before he was trafficked, warning him about trafficking. But trying his luck was still better than living in misery. So I was just wondering, how much do you think it can actually be done? And just wondering what you think about it.
You know, when I got to Phnom Penh in Cambodia, the first thing they gave me at the airport was this pamphlet about the how sex trafficking and sexual tourism are. You can end up in jail or even dead, you know, if you do that in that country. I jumped into the taxi and I told the taxi driver, you know, I'd like to have sex with a young boy. Can you get me there? And he said, of course. What kind of young boy do you want? So. That's the way it works. I don't think the pamphlets and the campaigns that most countries are doing are really working. And for example, the one in Bolivia, which is awful, they have this awful campaign that the American government, that USAID is showing everywhere. I don't know why, because they don't speak Spanish, I suppose. But this campaign is just has this the real survivors. Children, boys, men and women, telling their story of how they were raped, abused, exploited, enslaved, and everything. And then at the end of the campaign, of the two-minute thing, they go like, don't let them exploit you. And I go like, what do you mean, don't let them? I mean, it's just the worst campaign. That is what campaigns are doing almost all around the world, which is really, really stupid. There are some great campaigns. One in the United States, one we started based on that one in Mexico, and it's working, which is called I Am Not For Sale. Yo No Estoy En Venta. What we did in Cancun, just to prove if it worked, was we developed a toolkit for teenage kids. We said, okay, which ages they're taking them, you know, at what ages are they taking these kids to be exploited in the sexual industry in the area? And it was from 10 years old to 17 years old. So we said, okay, let's create this campaign. We made a video, we made a toolkit and everything. So we trained teenage kids and university college students to be trainers of kids their own age. And the whole toolkit contains material, videos and everything on education, on how the traffickers work, what you can do to protect each other, what peer pressure can do for you to be unsafe, how to save someone outside the school if somebody wants to snatch a girl or a boy or blah, blah, blah. And then we had this paper in which we asked each student at the end if they know a trafficker, if they know someone has been trafficked and everything. When I did that, my colleagues in Mexico were like, you're freaking crazy, you're a journalist. Nobody will say, yes, I know a trafficker, you know. So we started that campaign last year. We by now have trained 8,000 kids. And they are all so excited about it because they have the power of knowledge. They were not told that you're a potential victim, just go back to homes. But we gave them scenarios in which they could be caught, men or women, and what they could do, and we asked them to create ideas of how to protect themselves and create groups in their, you know, areas where they live and in the nightclubs and everything. So and they ended up organizing a big walk in Cancun, which the mayor wanted to forbid because it was demonstration in front of the tourists, but we did it anyway. And it was so cool because they went up and took the mic. All of the kids talk, none of us talk. And they told these stories, amazing stories, of how they knew someone that had been exploited somehow, or some trafficker. This guy went up and he said, I never knew that my uncle was a trafficker until I joined this campaign. Now I know he is, and I'm telling him, you know. So you cannot scare people. You have to give them tools, knowledge, and strategies, and help them develop their own strategies in local in terms, how to do and what they can do to survive. And then, of course, put a lot of pressure. I think the media plays a very important role into this pressure into politicians for public policies regarding, go back to the discussion on poverty, what poverty is doing, and these issues of trafficking and normalizing slavery. A lot of countries and politicians are saying, well, they're feeding them off. No. You have to change your public policies regarding this. But there are more and more poor people, so I guess.
Okay, I have, I'm being told there is just time for one more question. Two more, okay, so the last two, thank you.
Thanks very much. You've talked about raising awareness for people who are potential victims, but what about awareness raising which confronts the values, which I think you've brilliantly articulated, enable and make possible?
I can hardly hear you, I'm sorry.
I don't know if it's working or not. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm talking about, I'm asking the question about awareness raising, which is focused not on people who are potential victims, but changing and confronting the values, which is, I think you've really articulated so brilliantly, enable this kind of abuse to happen. Are you aware of any examples of that?
Yes, of course. Talking about this, for example, there are many campaigns. The one in the U.S. that started, some teenage kids started it, and now it's in many colleges, in the University of Michigan, the University of Utah. And what they are doing is they are challenging young men to understand what masculinity means, for example, what it would mean if you become a client, and what it means to be prostituted, not only as a woman, but also as a man or as a boy. And or as a transgender, for example, which is, this is an issue that almost nobody wants to talk about. That is terrible, because they're you know, discriminated like in many, many ways, and nobody wants to take care of them. For example, there's only one or two shelters around the world that take care of transgender victims of trafficking, because nobody wants to. They don't know what to do with it. They go with the taboo, like, oh, it's a man, it's a woman, it's what? It's so. We have to start talking about all those issues and what does the word values mean to you or to your society.
Hi, my name's Melissa, and I'm a lawyer who specializes in refugee and human rights law on the whole. So we deal with trafficking cases on quite a regular basis. It's perhaps not a very wise question as the last question, but most of the discussion seems to have been based largely on trafficking for sexual exploitation, mm-hmm. but of course there are many other different types, and I was wondering whether, even if, albeit that you're a very amazing woman, you managed to cover other areas of exploitation as well while you were doing all of your research.
Actually, in the book there's organ trafficking for organ trade in Israel, which is one of the countries that buys most illegal organs in the world and does the most operations, illegal operations, of course, of illegal organs in the world. And this is increasing. Chinese, I talk about some Chinese people that are brought from China to Mexico, and the way they will pay for their trip to Mexico is giving away a kidney once they are in Mexico for somebody that needs a kidney. So yes, I talk about that, and I did investigate labor exploitation a lot, but I didn't really publish most of the stories because there are a lot of books on that, really great books about that. You know, we know about these stories, and then almost everyone feels for a little boy or that is making this famous Nike soccer balls and stuff like that. Almost a lot of people knows how to stop that kind of, not buying clothing in certain areas that are being made, you know, by exploited workers and children and stuff. So that's why I concentrated on this issue and also organ trade and what else? I think that's it.
I think it's mostly around organs and trade. And I think what the book demonstrates is the interlinks between all of these forms of trafficking, whether it's drugs, whether it's people for work, for enslavement, people for sexual purposes. I mean, there is a lot of links with through the people who are running them, through the money system in place, through the routes that are being followed. You demonstrate the exchange between woman slave and drugs and so on, then the change into money, how. So it's very much intertwined. And I think what is interesting in Lydia's book, when she does talk about slavery for purposes other than sexual purposes, is the fact that clearly what emerged from that small comparison is that the human body for penetration, sexual penetration, is as an object of consumption. In the same way than you may use a young man to do something or a domestic worker, there is a real, the globalization of the trade, of the slavery trade, doesn't appear to make much distinction between whether people are enslaved for that purpose or another purpose. But you do point out that the majority of the slave trade is for sexual purposes, at least the existing data indicate that. I think I have to stop. We have to bring that conversation to an end. And Lydia, just as maybe as a last word, because it links up to your personal situation, maybe a couple of months ago, we all were very shocked to hear that Regina Martinez was murdered in Mexico. The sixth journalist in Mexico to be killed for doing her work, for reporting on political or social issues. And I know you had a conversation with her a few weeks maybe before she was killed. Can you maybe share with us a little bit more on what does it mean to be a journalist in Mexico? What does it mean to be an activist in Mexico? And what can we all do to support you and your colleagues who are really on the front line?
Well, I guess I was talking to a friend the other day. She's a correspondent, a German journalist. She's a correspondent, and she goes to Afghanistan and Iraq, and then she goes back home, and she's safe. And she asked me, how does it feel to go back, to live in the place where the war is and to be covering that war? And I've been thinking a lot about these issues. When I talked to Regina knew she had some death threats. The death threats that she got were very subtle. They weren't like anything similar to the ones I've got. They were very subtle, or politicians saying something almost like a joke, you know, don't mess up with this because one day you won't wake up and things like that. And when I told her to just do something about it, go to Mexico City, you know, we should make a safety, security strategy. She said, no, this is not going to happen to me. And we were talking before about this. I think when you're in the context of a war, as the one we are in Mexico right now, when 60,000 people has died in the last few years, has been assassinated in the last few years, which is not the same, it's not the cholera, it's the president that decided with Washington to get this massacre in order to supposedly stop the drug trade, which hasn't stopped at all. Then when you have 60,000 people assassinated in this context, the government has really made a huge effort to discredit all the work of journalists, especially of journalists like me, many of my colleagues that have been murdered or abducted or disappeared, that are naming everyone that is involved in this tragedy in Mexico. we are telling the names, we're doing the real investigation, and they want to discredit us. The president of Mexico said some years ago that I was the enemy of the people. And I'm like, okay, if doing the right thing and telling the truth is being the enemy of the people, then I am the enemy of your people, but not of my people. So what happens is when you live under so much stress, you develop one thing that is called post-traumatic stress syndrome. And then all of a sudden you're sometimes incapable of understanding how dangerous it is, the situation you're in. And you have to really work on that. And I've done my work on that. I go to therapy. I'm really serious about it because I know a lot of people that loves me, worries about me, and I want to stay alive, basically. It's very nice to be alive. So I don't care what people said. If every time I get a death threat, I just tell it to everyone, and I just go to the police and tell them I got the death threat and bring evidence. And some of my colleagues tell me, oh, Lydia, this is, you know, it seems like you want to attract attention. And I said, yes, I want to attract attention of the people that do not want to get me killed. You know, and if I just shut up, the ones that want to kill me, they will, as they have killed so many of my friends, not only journalists, as you know, but also NGO directors and especially feminist activists. So it's not easy. Of course it's not easy. But on the other hand, I know my job is useful, you know, and I think that one of the reasons why a correspondent goes to Iraq or Afghanistan is to bring the truth forward and to let people know that they should do something to change things. And that's what I'm doing in my own country, you know, to try to uncover the things that some people want really, really to be covered. And sometimes it's hard, and some other times it's very good when you see a sentence or, you know, and or when you get the time to go salsa dancing and have some tequilas and just laugh about everything, including the death threats, and just remember that there are a lot of good things in life and love and good sex and all that. Then you just combine the whole thing, you know. You just one thing I learned after I survived jail and torture was I just decided that very same day that I would never give this mafias my happiness, you know. This is something that's just like, I won't give them that. They've been trying to take everything away from us. They've been taking our money or safety or freedoms, and then I won't give them my happiness. So this is something I keep for myself, and I guess that helps a lot.
Thank you very much, Lydia. I don't think I should add anything.